home over the break. I think we might have been on our way back. And I got a text. My brother here was baptizing. I don't know anybody else got that text yet. You see that text? That brother, he took him down in water. And listen to me. I almost need to play it, let y'all hear it. He said, on the profession of your faith, dear brother, Lord Jesus Christ, as your personal Lord, he said, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Took him completely down. Your brother came out the water clapping, amen. Appreciate you, brother, amen. Bless the Lord. You not get another text. Somebody was afflicted somewhere. And I get a text that this brother here prayed the prayer of faith. The prayer of faith. And they're doing better, amen. Thank the Lord. So I just had to give that praise to the Lord. These two front row brothers. But, it's a tremendous thing. Their parents got them here. Don't think it's in vain. Don't we live in a dead age of parents. You give them what they call an option. I ain't have no option. It was church time. We were there. That's the option I had. Come and sit down and get a whooping. We ain't got no option. I appreciate both of you brothers. Amen. All right, let's get into the word now. Verse 15. Let me turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter 19. We'll go down to verse number 15. Begin our reading. I thank all those coming out tonight, your house of God, all those tuning to the broadcast. We appreciate you greatly. Genesis 19, 15.
And when the morning arose,
then the angels hastened Lot.
Saying,
Arise.
Take thy wife. And thy two daughters. Which are here.
Lest thou be consumed in the iniquity of the city. Here, a little background. Sodom and Gomorrah had gotten so wicked with ungodly living, quite similar to what's going on today. Just unbridled living. True. People wanting to do what they want to do. Yeah. Don't want to be constrained on any level. True. They want to have sex with whom they want to have sex with.
Come on, brother.
They want to do what they want to do. But let me just tell you, God got the last say.
Yeah.
All right.
There's some things that God will not put up with. And God would have to repent to Sodom and Gomorrah to put up with the foolishness that's going on in the generation of today. Now, while I do believe that the world is coming to an end, back then, we only find this particular, at this time, being so pervasive in Sodom and Gomorrah because of the wickedness of that city. But today, and people like to say, America is so wicked, but I want to tell you that this spirit is all over the world today.
Right.
This generation of this world, that's why the Bible said, this know also that in the last days, perilous times shall come. It won't be isolated, and that's when you know that the end of the world is near. It's not isolated to one geographical location. So here, Sodom and Gomorrah gotten so wicked, God told Lot, get your family and get out of Sodom and Gomorrah. And that's where our reading commences. Come on, verse 16.
And while he lingered, the men lay hold upon his hand. And upon the hand of his wife. And upon the hand of his two daughters. The Lord being merciful.
When God tell you to leave something alone, don't toy with it.
Amen.
When God say run from something, don't mess with it. While they lingered, they almost lost their experience, almost lost their lives.
Amen.
But God being merciful, thank the Lord, we serve a merciful God, amen.
Amen.
So God being merciful, come on.
Unto him.
Unto him.
And they brought him forth.
And they brought them forth.
And set him without the city.
My. What mercy? Set him without the city. Come on and read.
And it came to pass. When they had brought them forth abroad.
Uh-huh.
Then he said, escape for thy life.
Escape for thy life. Amen. Come on and read.
Look not behind thee. Neither stay thou in all the plain. Escape to the mountain. Lest thou be consumed.
On a side note, once you leave about a sin, don't you stay in the plain. Don't you stay in the justified state. You better get up as high as you can get in God.
Amen.
You better go on to a sanctified experience for real. When you get saved, God do away with your sins. Amen. You are justified, which is really a judicious terminology, meaning that you are acquitted for all the sins you've committed. You're justified, but don't stay there, my God. Get up in the mountain, amen. Settle all the way out. Let God know, Lord, I thank you for saving me. Now I want to consecrate the rest of my life. I want to do whatever you want to do with me, Lord. Lord, burn up my desire for my life. Lord, burn up my way, dear God. You burn up sin, now burn me up. I want to be all for you, Lord. Lord, I consecrate my life to you this day for you to use as you will. So here he said, escape to the mountain. Come on and read.
And Lot said unto them,
uh-huh.
Oh, not so, my Lord.
All right.
Behold now.
Skip down to verse number 23.
Haste thee, escape thither, for I cannot do anything till thou become thither.
Come on.
Therefore, the name of the city was.
Isn't that verse 23?
Oh, sorry. The
sun was risen upon the earth.
When Lot entered into Zora. Then the Lord rained upon Sodom and upon Gomorrah brimstone and fire from the Lord out of heaven.
Come on.
And he overthrew those cities and all the plain and all the inhabitants of the city.
Uh-huh.
And that which grew upon the ground. But his wife looked back from behind him, and she became a pillar of salt.
It says here, and his wife looked back behind him, and she became a pillar of salt. Tonight we're going to preach on the topic of a right look back spirit.
That's right. Amen.
A right look back spirit. Now, the Bible speaks about a look back spirit in two ways. There is a wrong look back spirit that will take you out of here. But there's a right look back spirit that you must possess in order to get to where God wants you to go. There's a spirit within us, a spirit that urges and yea compels us to look back to our past.
Yes, sir.
From time to time. And it's important for us to do away with the wrong look back spirit.
Yes, sir.
Because it will destroy us.
Amen.
But it's important for us to possess and embrace the right type of look back spirit.
Right.
And that's what we want to preach on tonight.
Amen.
Some people have lost their experience because they possess a wrong look back spirit. Others have lost out with God because they didn't possess the right look back spirit.
Amen.
So we're going to look into this, the right look back spirit. Well, here, Lot's wife, and it said she turned into what? A pillar of salt. I don't know, Michigan is salt is all 100. I don't know if there's anything as worthless as old salt. That's why the Bible said when the salt is lost, it's good for?
Right.
That's right.
In other words, if a person possesses a wrong look back spirit, and you're going to see what Jesus said about it. They're not fit. They, if you gave up the world,
that's right,
but you got something in you that's looking back to the world,
that's right.
Our desire is to be a light to the world and to compel the world to come to the kingdom.
Amen.
But
amen.
If we gave up sin, but we're yet looking back to sin, how can we convince those that are in sin to want what we got when we're looking back to what they got like we miss it?
That's
right.
My God.
He said she turned to a pillar of salt.
That's right.
Meaning that you're really good for nothing in the kingdom.
Amen.
So why and how did she possess this? Go back to verse number 15, our first verse. Come on and read.
And when the morning arose, then the angels hastened not, saying, Arise, take thy wife and thy two daughters, which are here, lest thou be consumed in the iniquity of the city.
All right. So here he said, go in verse 17. He said, look back, not behind thee, indicating a type. Don't look back to the life of sin that you gave up. But verse number 14, why did his wife look back? What causes people after they get saved to look back to the life of sin that they gave up? What can take place in a person's experience that will cause them, after they've been delivered, after God had mercy upon them, after he blessed them, after he saved them, what could cause a person to look back and possess a wrong look back spirit? Go back to verse number 14.
And Lot went out. And spake unto his sons-in-law. Which married his daughters. And said, Up! Get you up out of this place. For the Lord will destroy this city.
So Lot had more than just the two children that came up out of Sodom with him. He had some daughter-in-laws. These two that he took out with him, they were not married. Those were the ones he offered to the men of the city. Instead of the men of the city going after the men, the angels that had come and visited them, the two daughters he had, he took them with him and his wife. But he had some other children. And these children, he went to them. Read verse 12, 13, and 14. Come on real quick.
And the men said unto Lot, Hast thou here any besides?
Come on.
Son-in-law.
Come on.
And thy sons.
Come on.
And thy daughters.
Come on.
And whatsoever thou hast in the city, bring them out of this place.
Come on.
For we will destroy this place.
So he had others. So he went to them and said, come on, y'all, we got to get out of here. They're going to burn it up. Come on, we got to leave here. The angels came. They're going to burn it up. Please come. It said, but he seemed as one that mocked to his son-in-law. Oh, it's really going to burn up, huh? Oh, just some fire is going to just come down and just burn up. You want us to just leave? We had some fun inside. We're doing our thing here. And you want us just to leave this? Well, they seem as one that mocked, and their spouses had more influence than their holy father.
Wow.
Well, the father cut the ties and said, you two, come on. They came with them, they left. The mother, because the ties were so strong, she couldn't obey the angel that said, I don't care what is back here. I don't care what you feel about it. I don't care how close you was to that relationship in sin. I don't care how deeply you were involved in it. I don't care what you felt about him or what you felt about her. I don't care what you felt about this. You leave here and you don't look back.
My God.
But something in her was so tightly connected to what she left behind that she had to turn and just take one more look back at what she had gave up and left behind. Well, what happens here, this is what repentance is all about. But it is also what deliverance is about. My Lord, if you sense a tie too great to cut it off, if you sense a tie is too great, you cut it off, but you're struggling to let it go. When you get saved, you can't get saved unless you cut off all that you know to be sinful.
That's right.
I'm done with it.
Yes.
Amen.
But some things, and that's what good altar call is about. They'll ask you questions about, did you involve yourself in this?
Did you give yourself to it?
Yes.
Were you involved in a relationship? How deep was you involved in it? How long did you smoke? What aspect of it did you give yourself to it? Why? Because some stuff you're going to repent and that is behind you. But some stuff you may need deliverance from.
All right now.
And see, sometimes you got to understand, if you don't get the deliverance that you need,
right,
although you cut it off, it'll be something inside you that's still connected to it and still kind of care about it and still kind of miss it. And that's what the devil will work with and cause you to kind of text a little bit or call a little bit or Facebook a little bit. When you gave it up, you couldn't have gotten saved unless you gave it up. You can't sleep with her no more. You can't smoke that no more. But it's something in you that still kind of feel, and you want to know what she doing, who she with. You got to get back before God and you got to ask take the time from you. Take the desire from you. Take the longing in your heart from you.
Amen.
Because if that's not broken, eventually, after the service is over, after all the songs are sung, after your friend has been over the house exhorting you, after you listen to that CD, when the night gets lonely, when you feel that you're all alone, something within you will compel you to check on it, investigate it, give audience to it. The Bible said, I pray that you enter not into temptation. I pray that can a man handle fire in his bosom and not be burned? When an individual escapes from sin,
oh God,
but there's something that they cared about so much that was in that past life, God says, I have something for you. It's called deliverance.
Yes, sir.
You don't have to cry yourself to sleep.
Amen.
There may be some reaping, but the power of that thing can be broken.
Amen.
I don't care if you smoke 40 years.
Yes.
I don't care if you smoke weed every other week. I don't care if you're involved in whatever, this, that, and the other. There's a power in God.
Yes, sir.
Salvation should not be a struggle when it comes to the things of sin.
That's right.
The Bible said the way of the transgressor is hard.
Yeah. Right now.
He said, my yoke is easy. Yes, we go through trials.
Yes,
yes, we'll go through persecution, but he has grace for us.
Amen.
But it should never be a struggle to stay saved.
Yes.
It should never be a struggle to want to go to sin. No. The Bible said, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. That creature means new creation. When he creates you new, on that altar of prayer, he takes out your old mind, your
right
old
brain,
your old
God,
and gives you something new. You have a love for stuff that you didn't love. You used to didn't want to go to church, but now you can't wait to get to church.
Right,
you didn't want to read the Bible, but now you love reading the Bible. That's that new creation. You used to love to cuss folk out, but now you can't stand folk cussing folk out. You used to love to get involved in this, that, and the other, but now you see it for what it is.
My
God.
So when we have,
amen,
when we're able to get before God and say, Lord, if there's anything in me that is still has affections for the things that I gave up, I'm asking you to break it. I'm asking you to break it.
God help us.
We do not want to possess a bad look back spirit. And a bad look back spirit is when we look back to the life of sin and things we gave up and miss them and allow the devil to work on us. Two thoughts regarding the bad look back spirit. If it was sinful for you and you gave it up, it wasn't good for you to begin with. It was what was causing the heartache, the pain, the sick of the life you was living, going in circles, going nowhere. I remember my life just going in circles, going fast but nowhere, doing nothing. Same week, bro, you going to go, same thing, same people in the same place, over and over again.
That's right.
Yeah.
It's true, brother.
Amen.
So we have to remember, if it was sinful, it wasn't good for us in the first place. And it was what I was tired of when I got saved.
Yes, sir.
It ain't no different than it was then.
Yeah.
And number two,
point.
What God takes away, He'll give you something better in return.
Amen.
My Lord, He'll take away that sadness and give you joy.
Yes.
Take away that turmoil and give you peace.
Yes, yes.
Take away that loneliness and give you a comforter.
Yes,
take away that despair and give you hope.
Yes.
Take away that dark yesterday to give you a bright tomorrow.
Amen.
He takes away that ticket that you had on the train to hell and give you a transfer and a ticket on the train to heaven.
Oh my God.
Amen. When God takes something from you, stay in it long enough.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Get in it good enough.
Amen.
To be the good stuff.
Amen.
Amen. Get past this little bit. But go on into the things of God and let God start replacing that old crew you had with a good crew. This crew don't stab you back. This crew don't dog you out. This crew don't try to do this, that, and the other. This crew is loyal. Amen. It's called the family of God. Amen. The Bible says, therefore, many men be in Christ, He's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. Salvation is not just a bunch of stops. You stop this, you stop this, you stop. Yeah, you stop the stuff that's not good, but God replaces it with that which is much better.
Amen.
Much better. If you're not saved, you're tuning into the broadcast, or you're here tonight, I want to encourage you to get saved. A, because you need to be saved.
Amen.
Because you're going to give an account for all the sins you've done, and God is saying tonight, I will take away all the sins you've done.
That's right.
I, through my blood, will give an account all the sins you've done. I'll pay the ransom. You go free. But also, I have a better life for you.
Yes, sir.
I have a better life for you. You come. I was telling my wife today, I'm just so thankful. Walking to the bathroom, by my bedroom, I said, man, I didn't deserve salvation.
That's
right. I said, I didn't deserve the life that God has given me.
My God.
I didn't deserve to be saved. I didn't deserve to be able to tell my son, listen to what I say, but also watch what I do.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't deserve, my God, the blessings that God has given me. I had no idea, my God. The devil was making me think all he was showing me on that wall that day I got saved, all he was showing me was all the things I had to give up, Sister Coretta. He said, you ain't gonna do this, you ain't gonna be that. I said, man, here I am, my globe-trotting for the devil. I'm gonna sit at home. I didn't know I was gonna be globe-trotting for Jesus. Amen.
Yes.
Bless the Lord. Glory be to God. Amen. What God takes away, get in deep enough, He'll replace it with that which is better.
Amen. Amen.
Go over to Numbers chapter 11.
My God.
Numbers 11:1. The right look-back spirit. The right look-back spirit. Numbers 11:1. The Israelites look back. And look what the devil did. You got to be smart when you're dealing with the devil. Come on, 11:1.
And when the people complained, it displeased the Lord.
Uh-huh.
And the Lord heard it.
Come on.
And His anger was kindled.
You know, I was reading in a commentary today regarding that verse. And the commentator was expressing how grieved God was. For 400 years, y'all got hard taskmasters destroying you. And here you got the nerve to complain about anything? Transfer that to today. If you want to see a grieved God, you look down at a saint of God in the church of God, and you got the nerve to be complaining?
My God.
About anything?
My God, help us, help us.
7 billion people in the world. He had mercy upon your soul. The Bible said the wages of sin is death. You deserve to be in hell.
Yeah.
I had mercy time after time after time. Many of you was exposed to truth multiple times before you ever embraced it.
Right.
The Bible said this is the light of every man that come into the world. So God is obligated to lighten every human being at some point in their life to the need of salvation. But I passed that obligation and enlightened you a dozen times.
My God.
Some of you sat through 100 altar calls and I still dealt with you. the truth. Some folk have gotten saved, but they're in Babylon. They don't know the full truth. They just down there living off a morsel here and a morsel there. But you are in a fruitful hill. You got encouragement all around you. You got, my God, the seven seal of light. You got power and authority, testimonies of miracles. And you got the nerve to complain because somebody didn't speak to you?
All right now.
Because somebody didn't select you for... Because you feel this way? Are you sick? Because you didn't get that job promotion that you thought you should have got? The brother broke that down. He said, God was so grieved. Go down to verse number 5.
We remember the fish, which we did eat in Egypt freely, the cucumber, and the melon, and the leek, and the onion, and the garlic.
Stop it. The second thing, God makes you look back. One, he'll make you look back at things that you gave up, that you might have had a tie with. The second way that God or the devil will make you look back when you have a look back spirit is to look back at the quote unquote good stuff. The leaks and then, oh, I remember the part, I remember. You don't remember the heartache you felt by messing around with that nasty girl? That nasty boy. You don't remember thinking that you had AIDS for about 3 weeks. You don't remember the fact that you thought you had OD because they gave you some smoke and some stuff that you didn't know what was in it. And you didn't want to call them like because you was embarrassed. You don't remember the fact that you were battling depression to the point in which you thought about taking your own life. Won't you remember that? Won't you remember the fact that you were so bound and so messed up that your own friend, my God, did this to you and that to you and this, that, and the other? Won't you remember that? What the devil will do is try to have you remember the stuff. The Bible said there's pleasure in sin, but it don't last.
That's right.
And you're going to reap for it. Amen. And you're going to pay a high premium price for it.
My God.
But the second way the devil will cause you to have a look back spirit is to try to get you to look back at something that was, quote unquote, a little bit of pleasure. But you better be wise enough to look at the totality of all that was in sin. Amen. Those hard taskmasters. How you felt after you did it, so on and so forth. There might have been some pleasures, but they didn't last. They left me feeling worse after I involved myself in it. They left me with scars from pain that it cost me. Many scars that I have now will never go away. That's what many people are able to say. The scar, they only had to look back at that. Some woman had to look back, and they said that I was in sin, I was involved in this, the guy wasn't no good, so I went and I had an abortion, I did this, and I did it. She said, the story goes that every time she would walk past a nursery and hear a baby now, she would remember what she, the scars. Sometimes your reaping will continue.
Yes.
Give you a reminder of what you
done.
But the devil ain't gonna show you all that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's important to understand, one, if you look back to stuff that you gave up, that you may have still an affinity for, and number two, he'll have you looking back at the quote-unquote good part, or the favorable aspects, or the pleasures that were in sin, instead of the pain that those pleasures caused.
Yeah.
Paul, over to Philippians chapter 3, Paul was able to get the victory over looking back at the good parts by a consecration that he made. Philippians 3, go straight to verse number 5.
Circumcised the 8th day of the stock of Israel.
Come on.
Of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews.
Come on, so I had platinum records. My song was three songs below Beyonce's on the chart. I was the number one draft pick. I had signed by this modeling agency. I had it going, so I had to give up some stuff to get saved. I was that girl. I was that guy. Read.
As touching the law, a Pharisee.
Come on.
Concerning zeal, persecuting the church.
Come on.
Touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless.
Come on.
But what things were gained to me?
What thing were gained to me? Come on.
I counted loss for Christ.
I counted loss for Christ.
Amen.
Come on.
Yea, doubtless. And I count all things. But loss. For the excellency.
Of the knowledge of Christ Jesus.
For whom I have suffered the loss
For whom I have suffered the loss of all things,
and do count them
but dung, that I may win Christ, I may get what he has for me. If you want to get the full victory of over looking back at the good stuff, you're going to have to count. I don't care if it was good, bad, or indifferent. I count it all but dung.
Of
horse manure. Excuse my crudeness. It don't mean nothing to me. Don't stand up promoting what you do. Well, I was just out. That don't mean nothing. That don't mean nothing. It dumb to me. I was not worthy of the least of the mercies of God. I'm not worthy to be a doorkeeper in the house of God. I was nothing before he found me. I was messed up. I was lost. You saw the good part. You didn't see the bad part. I was all. I was messed up. And I count anything that you would consider that I had to give up but dung. And you won't ever find anybody looking back to dung. So when you're able to get that consecration in order, you're able to have a mindset that will prevent you from looking back at even the leeks and the onions. Let's go over to good ways that we are to look back. Ezekiel 16, verse 1. Tonight we're speaking on the right look back spirit. Possessing the right look back spirit. Ezekiel 16, 1.
Again the word of the Lord came unto me saying.
Those that you find staying saved for a long time, they possess the right look back spirit. Those that you see in and out, gone, many times they possess a wrong look back spirit. When they get into a difficulty, they'll look back the wrong way. Let's look at the good look back spirit. Go ahead.
Son of man. Cause Jerusalem.
To know her abominations.
And say.
Come on.
Thus saith the Lord God unto Jerusalem.
Yes.
Thy birth and thy nativity is of the land of Canaan.
Come on.
Thy father was an Amorite, and thy mother an Hittite.
In other words, you was a mixed heritage. You didn't even really, you weren't even pure Jew. You weren't even really one. You need to look back at the mercy that God had on you. You need to look back at the guilt that you had. Amen. You need to look back that you wasn't nothing. You need to look back that you wasn't one of those good ones that God came and got. You need to look back that you didn't deserve to be saved. You need to look back at your inheritance. It wasn't nothing in your lineage that denoted that you should have been, amen, in the child or in the household of faith. Come on and read.
And as for thy nativity.
Come on.
In the day thou was born, thy navel was not.
God said, Israel, if you don't look back at this. Come on and read.
Neither was thou washed in water.
Come on.
To supple thee.
Come on.
Thou was not softened at all.
Come on.
Nor swaddled at all.
Read.
None I pitied thee.
Nobody pities you. Nobody really cared about you. You would say you was hurting. You would say I'm going through, but there was nobody that really had your back. There was nobody that really felt you.
Yes.
There was nobody that was really a ride or die for real with
yes.
you, as they say in this generation.
Yes.
There was nobody that really was right there for you.
Yes.
None I pitied you, but I.
Yes.
My Lord,
hallelujah.
Look at you. Most people are dogging you out. Those friends that you had, they was laughing in your face as soon as you turned your back. They was laughing at you. They was laughing with you when you was with them, but laughing at you as soon as you left. My God. But God still looked down and said, they may laugh at you, but I see something in you that I can use. I see something in you that's worth saving.
Yes.
You may not mean nothing to them, but you mean everything to me. I sent my son Jesus to die on the cross that you may be free. I didn't send him to die for the church. I sent him to die for the world. Those that were messed up. Those that were polluted in their own blood. Those that were guilty. Those are the ones I sent my son to die for.
Amen.
Come on and read.
To do any of these things unto thee.
Come on.
To have compassion upon thee.
Come on.
But thou wast cast out in the open field.
In the open field. Read.
To do the lowling of thy person.
Come on.
In the day that thou wast born.
Come on.
And when I passed by thee.
And when I passed by thee.
And saw thee polluted in thy own blood.
Polluted in thy own blood. Guilty. Messed up. Yes. Come on, read.
I said unto thee.
Come on.
When thou wast in thy blood.
When thou wast in thy own blood about to die. Come on and read.
Live.
Yea,
I said unto thee, when thou was in thy blood, live.
Come on and read.
I have caused thee to multiply. multiply.
I didn't just say live, but I've caused thee to multiply. I've blessed you. So here, he said, a good look back spirit is when you look back, as God told Israel, that how messed up you was. And you need to do that from time to time.
Yes.
There's a song that said, roll back the curtain of memories now and then. Show me where you brought me from and where I could have been. Remember, I'm human and humans forget. Remind me, dear Lord, remind me. And when you have a little bit of pride trying to kick in and you say that, but I wasn't as bad as Sister So-and-so. The song poet said what I could have been. You can really shift that in your case and put should. What you should have been.
God.
The mercy of God.
Amen.
What God's you should have been. You may say, so-and-so had been, I should have had
him. Amen.
It wasn't nothing but the mercy of God. So-and-so was addicted, I should have been addicted. It wasn't nothing but the mercy of God. That night I was about to leave. That night I was about to run away. That night I was about to dip. I couldn't take it no more, but mercy cried out and helped me. That night I was about to get in that car with my friend. That night I was about to smoke that joint, but something stopped me. Something held me. Something prevented me. What I should have been. But mercy cried out. When you keep that humility in your mind and say, Lord, I should have been in prison. Could never laugh at nobody. So also got a record. I should have every record that they had.
That's right, brother.
But God had mercy upon my soul.
Yes.
Go over to Exodus 1, verse 8. So one, a good look back is to look back at how guilty and messed up we were. The second is to look back at how bound we were.
Yeah.
Exodus 1:8. Come on, read.
Now there arose a new king over Egypt. Which knew not Joseph. And he said unto his people.
Come on.
Behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we.
Listen, sin may be okay for you for a little bit, but eventually sin will turn.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Amen.
Let me tell you.
Egypt was good for a little bit. Mm-hmm. But eventually a kingdom rose. You may be the man on the street, but eventually they're going to get you.
That's right.
You may be that one for a little bit, but eventually it's going to turn them. Yeah. It may be all that, and that was going on with stuff, whatever. Hey, man, how you doing? But eventually,
yes,
those same ones, that girl just had it going on, but eventually you're going to see the effects of sin.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to see the king. Not Joseph. Want to read?
Come on, let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply. And it come to pass that when there falleth out any war, they join also unto our enemies and fight against us. And so get them up out of the land.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, they did set over their taskmasters to afflict them with their burden.
My lord.
And they built for Pharaoh treasure cities.
Stop right there. Second, we want a good look back spirit. It's to look back at how bound we were.
Yes, sir. Amen.
One was to look back at how polluted and guilty, and we didn't deserve it. But the second is to look back at how bound we were. And just work with me just for a moment on this point, saints. Anybody that's truly saved tonight.
Oh, God.
If they search deep enough in their hearts, they will be able to say, I had wanted to be saved before.
That's true.
The day I got saved, I had thought of getting saved before. I had sat through an altar call where God was dealing with me before. And let me bring it in. And if they look deep enough, they will say that it was a borderline miracle that I got saved.
Yes.
If they really examine themselves, they will be able to tell you it's a miracle. You don't understand. Listen, saints, I personally had a reasoning spirit. Anytime the thought of salvation comes, It was a spirit that would come into my mind and give me a perfectly reasonable reason why not to get saved at that moment. Unbelievably efficient and effective. Unbelievable. It was greater than my own ability to compute information. It was a spirit. It would tell me that if the plane is going down, then right before it hit the ground and the gas erupts and it blows up, right before, you will be able to say, in the name of Jesus, forgive me. And go on the glory. And I would believe it. It would say, if you're in a car and you're riding and y'all sticking in on 94 and y'all going down here to the ice patch because your boy was drinking and you was wanting to be with him and that car hit the ice patch and you're flipping, boom, church, you got a child. Boom, Jesus, in the name of Jesus, I'm sorry for all my sins. You say, oh, boom. I actually thought that while the car was flipping over, that I would have the ability to get on my knees real quick and say, God, forgive me right now. I'm sorry. Prince. Eternity. Yes, Jesus. Like I said, right till 94. I did. I said it. I had no idea that the scripture says no man can come unto me except my Father draw him. It takes conviction. It takes God drawing. And then you got to pay the count the cost and pay the price. And you have to go deeper than your situation. You have to hit the rock. That's why Jesus told the Pharisee, don't come unless you bring forth fruit. What is the fruit? The fruit is genuine brokenness, godly sorrow, and contrition. In that situation, I don't have godly sorrow. I got hell afraid of. Any words that I said was going to be as a sounding brass in the tin. Ain't no magic in no words. God is looking at your heart.
Yes, he is.
Amen.
That is the truth. Thank you, Lord.
But that old reasoning spirit was teaching me false doctrine all my childhood in the church of God, and I thought, oh, if I get AIDS right before the day I die, when I'm filled with sores all over my body, and I'm in the hospital, and they say, this is last moments of living. Doctors come in the room, and I'm going to say, call for the ministry. Bring them in. Pray for me. In Jesus' name, forgive me. I want to be saved right now. Dead. I thought honestly that I was going to get saved on my deathbed filled with AIDS. But God,
amen,
had mercy. The taskmasters, they held them strongly. I was being held by spirits. I was sitting in the altar call, my hands sweating. I would find something to do to distract me because I didn't like the feeling of conviction dealing with my soul. I'd go to the bathroom. We had old ushers back then that stand in front of the bathroom door. In front of the door. They would sit, they could smell. You want a conviction, go back and sit yourself down.
Yep.
You ain't got to go to no bathroom. You already went. Go before you go. Hold it. Go back and sit down. Play no games with you. So cut all that out. The old Holy Ghost parents back then, they would come to somebody, back then, the girls, if they get a little bit older, about 15, 16, they wouldn't say, they go get somebody's baby, making sense. The Holy Ghost coming. Oh, says Nikki, can I see your baby? Oh, they go to the bathroom, back room, holding the baby, trying to fight conviction. Oh, the Holy Ghost, give my baby back. And Lord, we pray, Lord, deal with her in the name of Jesus. Just trying anything to fight conviction. All those things was hard taskmasters. Spirits holding you back. And if you think for one moment how difficult it was for you to get saved, it'll cause you, how low you get, I ain't looking back at them. How difficult it was for me to get here. Listen, I may gotta cry. I may ask you to forgive me. God, I may gotta do what I got, but I ain't going back.
Amen.
I ain't going back. I know it was too hard for me to get out the first time for me to ever consider going back again. I may get weak. I may fall on one knee. I may have to crawl, but I ain't never going to look back.
Amen.
I'm not going to look back.
Right.
Why? Because I understood how hard it was for me to ever get out the first time. With the time that I have now. Last, go over to Psalm 40, verse 1.
I'm blessed.
The good look back spirit. Look back to how guilty and messed up you were. Look back to how bound you were and how difficult it was. You can get out the first time. Psalm 40, verse 1. You want to read it?
I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me.
My Lord, David said, I waited patiently for the Lord. It took time, my God.
I didn't get saved the first altar call. I waited patiently on the Lord. And really, my God, God waited patiently on me. My Lord. I waited patiently on the Lord, and he inclined unto me. My Lord. Yes.
And heard my cry.
And heard my cry, my heart's cry. Come on and read.
He brought me up also out of a horrible pit.
He brought me up out of a, look back at the horrible pit he brought me up out of. The horrible pit of sin.
Yeah.
That's how you gotta see sin. Sin ain't cool. You can't never impress me in sin. Sin is a horrible pit. I don't care what you drive. I don't care what kind of purse you got. I don't care what kind of glasses you wear. I don't care how tight your clothes is. I don't care what kind of music you got. I don't care what that little girl look like you got. Look what that boy look like you got. Sin is a horrible pit. You tell Oprah, you tell Beyonce, you tell MJ, you tell LeBron, you tell anybody else, you tell them all, my God, Justin Bieber, you tell all of them, my God, sin is a horrible pit. They're not cool, they're foolish, my God. They don't impress me at all, my God. Sin is a horrible pit. How you dress it up, I don't care, it's still horrible. How you make it look cool, I don't care, it's still horrible. You gotta keep that in your mind. It's horrible. Don't make nobody cause you to think you're missing out. You're not missing out on nothing. You're missing out on the heartache. You're missing out on the headache.
Praise
you're missing
God.
Out on the hypocritical lifestyle. Why is it hypocritical? It's hypocritical because they all fake it. They all phony. They all, my God, faking around. They act like they're happy. They're not happy. They act like they got peace. But the Bible said there is no peace. The Bible said the wicked is as a troubled sea.
Yeah.
How cool you try to act, it ain't that cool. Deep on the inside, after the lights go out, you crying yourself to sleep. You want a better way. You want the life that we got. You want to be like them. You want to have God on the inside. You want to have peace that passes understanding. You want to have joy. You want to have, my God, a power to tell the devil no.
Yes.
Say he saved me apart of a horrible pit. Come on and read.
And set my feet upon a rock.
My Lord, and upon the miry clay. My Lord, the miry clay. That's talking about that quicksand. Those aspects of sin that keep you bound. My Lord, quicksand, the more steps you take, the more you try to get out of it, the deeper you go in it, my God. And that's how sin is with those habits and those spirits of sin. My God, they'll hold you down the more you try to get out of sin. The more to pull you down. You try to get out and pull you down. But David said, I don't only celebrate the fact that you brought me up out of a horrible pit, but that pit had some clay in it. There was some bondage. There was some habits that had to be broken in order for me to get saved. There were some spirits I had to be dealt with in order for me to get saved. But God, you didn't just save me out of a horrible, horrible pit, but you broke those spirits.
Praise God.
You brought me up out of the miry clay. The more I tried to get out, the deeper I went. But one day, a hand stretched from out of nowhere and grabbed hold of me and brought me above and set my feet upon the rock, the sure foundation. And that rock was Christ. Now when the winds come and the storms blow, I'm on the rock. I may shake a little, but I'm solid. I may shake a little, but I'm solid. My foundation is a rock. And that rock is Christ. And that rock is Christ.
Amen.
I may go through something. People may turn their back on me. I may go through something. I may lose a job. I may not have all the money I need, but I'm on the rock.
Amen.
I'm on the rock, my God. So after the wind blows, after the storm goes, you will still find me standing because I'm on the rock. Come on,
and established my bones.
And he didn't just set me up on the rock, but he's established my bones. I don't care if you've been saved for a day, or for a year, or 40 years. God set you up on a rock. You've been saved one day, you had to go home, and you had to deal with some stuff. But he established your goals. He helped you to deal with some things you had to deal with. He helped you and showed you what you had to work with this. Establish your goals. My God, when you had to tell a friend that, God helped to establish your goals. God showed you how to read scripture, how to understand the word of God, how to appreciate the songs of God. He's established your going. Here David said, the third way in which we look back in a good way, a good look back spirit, is to look back at how he saved us, delivered us, and established us. And he said, and he put a new song in our mouth. My Lord, a song of joy, a song of, see, your life sings a song. Your life sings a song. Many of our lives were singing a song of sorrow. Mm-hmm. Our lives were singing the blues. Mm-hmm. Our lives were singing songs of heartache. But we put a new song in our mouth. A song of joy. What happened to you? I got saved. That's what happened. Amen. Amen. Right, a song of joy. And we won't be able to go all the way into it. But when the children of Israel was coming out of the wilderness going to Canaan, it came through what's called the Jordan River. And God stopped and said, take out 12 stones and put these stones here. And they said, why? And they said, so later on, when generations come, I want you to be able to tell them what I did for you here. It's imperative that in our experience, that we go through our trials right.
Amen.
I don't care how small they seem, go through your trials right. From the first day of your salvation until the last, till you cross over and go into glory. Go through your trials right. Because in those trials, when God brings you through, you're going to be able to look back and use those trials as stepping stones.
My God, Lord, help us.
And say, Lord, I remember when I got saved.
Yes.
I didn't think I was going to last a day.
Mm-hmm.
But you kept me a day. I didn't think I was going to last a day. I didn't think I could fit. I was like, man, I don't fit. The younger people is too young. The ones that got saved, they already had their own little crews. The older people, they was married doing their own thing. And it's nothing as far away to a single saint than a married saint. Y'all so young, you can't even relate to me. I'm like, what can you say to me, bro? After this over with, you going on with your little whatever. You ain't feeling my pain. You want something different. Now, once a person gets married, if I only knew. When I could just go to bed when I wanted to, didn't have to get nobody, didn't have to deal with nobody else, didn't have to do, I could just do me. Are you serious? It's amazing how Jesus said, well, anyway, but now, the enemy brought me through it. And he told, when David was going up against Goliath, he had a good look back spirit. He looked back at the lion.
Yes.
He looked back at the bear.
Yes.
When everybody else didn't possess the right look back spirit because they had things in their life that they could have looked back to. If it wasn't things in their life, all they had to do was look back at their history and look back to the Red Sea. But they didn't have a good look back spirit. They was looking at what they were facing. When you're facing a giant, you better roll back the curtain of a good look back spirit and see where your stepping stones are at so you can say that this uncircumcised Philistine,
yes, sir.
The Hebrew boys, when they were going to the fiery furnace, the Daniel, going to the lion's den, they were able to look back when they wouldn't defile themselves with the king's meat. But they were fairer than those that did eat the king's meat. So when they said bow, it wasn't that they were that strong, saints. It wasn't that David, get the spirit and we're done. It wasn't that they were that strong. They had a good look back spirit. If you don't have a good look back spirit, when you are going through and your feet is in the fire and it looks like you can't go another day, and that doctor says this, and you're dealing with this bill, and you're dealing with that, trust me, your faith will fail you.
My God. You ain't
strong enough. You ain't powerful enough. You need to go through your trials right. As the pastor said yesterday, you can't just say so-and-so. So you need some stuff for yourself.
Amen.
You need things for yourself.
Amen.
Knowing that God brought me through this.
Yes.
God did this for me. And I'm going to look back to what he did for me to carry me through what I'm going through now.
Amen.
And if I go through anything in the future, he'll carry me through
my
that
God.
As well.
Thank you, Lord.
Possessing a good look back spirit. That's
my
Father, we thank you for your
goodness.
We appreciate you, dear God, for your word. We're thankful, dear God, that in the toolbox of salvation, there's everything that we need to help us to make it all the way through. And Father, tonight our burden, dear God, you laid upon us, dear God, was the importance of Israel, the importance of the church of God, the saints of God, to possess a right look back spirit. And not a wrong. Help every one of us tonight, dear God,
to not possess any element of a spirit that will cause us to look back and even consider going back to sin again, or looking back on the things of our life of sin favorable in any light whatsoever. And Lord, help us to possess a good look back spirit at how we didn't deserve mercy. We were polluted in our own blood, but you had mercy upon us. We were bound with hard taskmasters, and it was a miracle that we ever got saved to begin with, and we're never going to take a chance again to God. And Lord, may we not forget about that horrible pit, that miry clay, and how you brought us up out of it, delivered us, established us, and have strengthened us to the day we're at today. And Lord, there are saints that are going through trials right now. And Lord, the thing that's going to carry them through is possessing a good look back spirit. Seeing where you brought them from. Seeing how you come through for them before. David said at the end of his life, I've been young, but now I'm old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken. Lord, help us to even look back at how you brought the saints through. Hebrews 11, a look back chapter. Help us, dear God. We love you from the depths of our hearts. We're battling unbelief like never before, but we can make it through if we utilize every tool in our toolbox. And one of them is possessing the right look back spirit. Bless the saints tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Tonight, if anybody is not saved,